You're watching NBC, home of primetime NFL football on Sunday night with the best team and the biggest games.
Welcome to the ADT Security NBC Sports Update. Here's your host, Andrea Joyce.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to our New York studio. Coming up in just a moment, NASCAR Busch Series racing from Memphis. Then at 4:30 Eastern, we'll have figure skating Glade Halloween on Ice starring Nancy Kerrigan. In baseball, one of the more unpredictable postseasons in recent memory came to an end last night. The St. Louis Cardinals looking to clinch against the Detroit Tigers. Game 5 from Busch Stadium. Bottom of the fourth, fielding problems continue for Detroit pitchers. For the fifth straight game, a Tiger pitcher commits an error. Justin Verlander's wild throw to third allows the Cards to tie it. St. Louis added another run to take a 3-2 lead. Meanwhile, Jeff Weaver pitching the game of his life, 8 innings, 9 strikeouts, gave up just 4 hits and 1 earned run. Top of the ninth, Adam Wainwright on to close. He gets Brandon Inge swinging, and St. Louis, with just 83 wins in the regular season, wins its first World Series in 24 years. And that brings us to our ADT Security Good Sport Award, and for that, we stay with the World Series. And Detroit manager Jim Leland, who turned around the Tigers in his very first season and who was the model of class and sportsmanship even as the Tigers were eliminated. And for that, we honor him with the ADT Security Good Sport Award. And we'll see you a little bit later on. Right now, off to Memphis for NASCAR Busch Series Racing.
This has been the ADT Security NBC Sports Update. ADT Security Services, the world leader in home and business security.
Two racing champions from different worlds headline today's NASCAR event. Kevin Harvick, the Southern Californian, who's already won the NASCAR Busch Series Championship and trying to make it a Nextel Cup double. And Juan Pablo Montoya, the former Indy 500 winner and Formula One star from Colombia, making his NASCAR debut. The fans following Montoya have brought an international flavor to the birthplace of rock and roll as NBC Sports brings you race 32 of the NASCAR Busch Series from Memphis Motorsports Park. Beautiful weather, a great crowd on hand, and expecting an exciting short track race with the stars of NASCAR slugging it out on this very fast three-quarter mile track. Sellout crowd has filed in. You see the teams beginning to clear pit road where the cars are gridded and getting ready for the start of today's NASCAR Busch Series race. There's Montoya, the subject of so much attention here this weekend. The former Formula One star who basically stunned the racing world when he decided he wanted to go NASCAR racing. A lot of people ask why. He says because it's a challenge and he loves to race. Montoya with his NASCAR stock car debut here today. As you see down trackside now, they're gathering the dignitaries and getting ready for the opening ceremony.
Let's pray together, please. Our Heavenly Father, we're grateful for this beautiful day. Thank you, Lord, for this great country that we enjoy so many blessings of life and liberty. Lord, today we remember those who are serving far from home. We pray, God, that you would bless them as they preserve and protect our liberties. Father, we pray your protection today on the drivers, the crew members, the fans. Lord, and most of all, we thank you for your love and your mercy and your grace. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
We mix music with motorsports here at Memphis Motorsports Park. And my good friend John Snyder from Dukes of Hazzard and a brand new movie coming out, Collier & Company, with our national anthem. John?
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave? Yes, it does. O'er the land of the free and the home of the
Snyder, appreciate it very much. Ladies and gentlemen, are you ready to go racing? How about it?
We're ready to go racing, and the teams are too. We hope you are as well. Welcome to Memphis. Alan Bestwick with Wally Dallenbach. Looking forward to an exciting race this afternoon. If you like your racing with a lot of passing, then this is the place to be.
Again, you can start from the back.
Yeah.
Because the Cup guys just showed up a few minutes ago. You've got a bunch of those guys back there. Four good cars are in the back. It's going to be fun watching those guys cut through the field. The championship's been decided, so they're here to have a good time and have fun. But there's a lot of other guys here that are working for jobs. Jason Keller on the front row. I mean, here's a guy that's a proven Busch winner in the series, and he's on a different agenda. These guys are auctioning for jobs. I mean, these guys are trying to find sponsors for next year. They're trying to keep their teams together. So you've got some guys here that are here to have a good time, and you have some guys here that are really working on next year's programs.
Jason Keller told me this morning that it's nice to have a chance to audition with a good car.
That
in
helps.
Front of the field.
That
yeah.
helps.
Get a chance to do something based on what I do today instead of what I've done in the past. And then way in the back, the guys like Denny Hamlin and so on. And what about Juan Pablo Montoya? How's he going to fare today in his first ever fender-banging NASCAR short track race? We'll find out. Montoya with a good car and a good starting spot. We'll see. He told me his goal was just to get to the finish with all the fenders on the car. That's a good goal for the day for him, you think?
That's a very good goal. Tough goal.
We'll see how it turns out. Start engines next. NASCAR Busch Series Racing for Memphis is brought to you by Propane. New Propane, exceptional energy. By FreeCreditReport.com. Log on to FreeCreditReport.com and get the score. And by Suzuki, maker of performance-driven motorcycles, scooters, and all-terrain vehicles.
Charlotte,
the 2006 NASCAR Busch Series champion.
Myra, I'm a little bit worried about her. There's so much sunshine. She's
NBC Sports welcoming you to Memphis Motorsports Park and the NASCAR Busch Series, presented by Propane. It was a wacky race the last time these cars were on the track a week ago Friday in Charlotte with the little scoring snafu, all the crashes, the leader getting taken out. We can't possibly have that crazy a race here today, can we?
Oh, yes, we can.
Especially here on the short track in Memphis. 15 cautions in this race a year ago. Who's going to survive the day? And will the Cup guys coming from the back of the field get through cleanly to have a chance to race for the win? Should be fun to watch them make their way up through the traffic. Nice weather, sellout crowd, and some dignitaries trackside to get the day started.
Memphis Motorsports Park, it's a howling good time with Elvira, the mistress of the dark, and Queen of Halloween, the most famous words in motorsports.
Gentlemen, start your engines! Woo!
Done with enthusiasm and style. Good way to start the day. Come on.
Yeah.
43 drivers set to go. 250 laps in the three-quarter mile Memphis Motorsports Park. The green flag is next on NBC.
Seventh win of the season for Harvick. 17th finish in the top three. His 24th win in the Busch Series. That ties him for third all time.
Kevin Harvick. Harvick has already clinched the NASCAR Busch Series Championship for 2006, but still a lot to be raced for. Who's going to finish second? There are differences in end-of-the-year prize money awards for all of those positions. Who's going to make the top 10 and make the stage at the Series Awards Banquet in Orlando? Top 10 is kind of a racing thing. You make the top 10 at the end of the year, you've done something.
Yeah, that's what you're always shooting for, is top 10. That's what they show on TV.
There you go.
So that's what, you know, that's where you're trying to get.
Field rolling off for the pace laps. Let's take a look at the starting lineup for today's race. Qualifying held a couple of hours ago. Johnny Sauter outran them all to the pole position.
How about rookie Willie Allen in his first Busch start? Really nice start for him.
First ever, and he's a track champion at the Nashville short track from this summer. Now, Kevin Harvick and all the other cup guys you see in there, like Yaley, are going to have to drop to the back because they were not here for qualifying this morning. They were down in Atlanta doing final practice for their Nextel Cup cars for tomorrow's 500-mile of air. So they'll all fall to the end of the field on these pace laps. Clint Boyer, one of those, it'll go to the back also.
Well, quite a few rookies in this race here today. The guy's getting some track time.
Tim Schindel was the Midwest Series NASCAR Regional Series champion this year.
Getting one of the Sauters in there, one of the three that are here today.
There's the third, Tim, down in row 18. New guys, first ever Busch Series start. Dexter Bean. It's a young man out of Wisconsin. Got a lot of Wisconsin guys in the field today. And a lot of guys who didn't make the race. Huge field of cars turned out to try and qualify for this thing. 51 entries for the 43 starting spots. All the guys that have to go home without racing.
That's a pretty strong car count here this weekend, for sure. We sent seven guys home.
All right, couple laps away from the start today. Let's hear from our reporters on pit road for the afternoon. We start with Lindsay Zarniak.
It's made for Johnny Sauter. One small change has made all the difference. This is his first race under his new crew chief, Booty Barker, and already the two feel like they share the same language. They hope that language is winning. The last time Johnny Sauter had a pole at Memphis was 2001 in the ASA series. He ended that day in victory lane. To Ralph Shaheen.
Lindsay, lots of commotion around Juan Pablo Montoya making his first NASCAR start here in the Busch Series at Memphis, but he's been here before. He came and tested a Nextel Cup car here, and when he got back here with his Busch car, it only took him seven laps yesterday to get quicker than he'd ever gone here in the Cup car. As far as braking goes, he said that shouldn't be a big issue for him here, even though in Formula One, the drivers tend to run it to the very last brake marker, stop on the pedal, and then turn the car in. He says, I've never been hard on brakes. I'm usually very easy on my braking, and that has allowed him, Alan, to adjust to the braking with these Busch Series cars.
I don't know if there's ever been a driver who's made his NASCAR debut under more expectations than Juan Pablo Montoya.
No, I think you're right, Alan. I mean, there's, you know, here's a guy that's an Indy 500 winner. You know, he's run Formula One, won a lot of IndyCar races, and now he's in the Busch Series. And, you know, the guy's got talent. There's no question about that. But this is a different ballgame. You know, in Formula One, the race cars are the stars. I mean, whatever you had there, you know, there's one or two teams you need to be driving for to win races.
Yeah.
You've got a lot of good teams here. You've got a lot of really good drivers in NASCAR. So it's going to be a little bit different for him. But he's with a very good team. Chip Ganassi's going to put the best equipment that he can put under him. He's going to give him every opportunity he can. So he's going to have a good shot just having great equipment.
You saw the Cup guys dropping to the tail end of the field. We'll watch them try and come through the traffic. Johnny Sauter, 00. Jason Keller, 66 on the front row. 250 laps in Memphis about to get underway. Montoya slow to get away in the 42.
Yeah, he didn't get a very good start there. He's down on the inside right now of Kenny Wallace. That's really a good place to be.
Down to the bottom.
Down on the bottom.
Yeah. But as I mentioned earlier, this race last year had 15 caution flags in it. That's a ton. There was a lot of stop and go racing. We'll see if it's a little more cleanly run today or not. Especially with all those cut guys way out the back trying to come up through.
The temperature's really cool. It's going to take some laps to get these tires on, you know, get some heat in these tires. But everybody's being real careful right there in the middle. There's a race for fourth right there. That's it. That rookie we were talking about, Willie Allen, and a 14 car on the bottom.
And Bernie Lamar and Kevin Harvick, 77. Harvick owns that car. Actually, Delano owns the car, but... Side by side a little bit farther back in the field. Although, speaking of Kevin Harvick trying to pick his way through the traffic, 21 car on the outside, the blue and orange machine.
Yeah, these guys will start slicing through the field pretty quick. They'll be passing two or three cars a lap for a while. Then as they get further and further up in the field, it's going to get a little bit tougher to pass some of these guys. But right now, they're a lot faster than these cars in the back. Saw a car hit real sideways right in front of the two car there, Clint Bowyer. He's carefully picking his way through this traffic right now.
That's Casey Kane on board.
He's just got to be patient. You can see that Casey's just kind of riding right now. He's just waiting to see what line's going. And just got to be patient these opening laps until things start stringing out. And you can start passing cars. Because right now, if they're side by side in front of you, there's not a whole lot you can do until the line opens up.
A little farther ahead in line, 33 on the move. That's Cale Gale, another one of the young kids, 21 years old, Mobile, Alabama, driving for Kevin Harvick Incorporated. He's got Brad Keselowski, 23, behind him. Ooh, he shuffles up. And 35 is Regan Smith, going next L Cup racing next year. Going to be Mark Martin's teammate.
What's going on with Mr. Montoya there, Ralph?
Oh, Wally, you guys are talking about the lack of green flag laps. You know, last year we only had 36 straight green flag laps at a time, which is not a whole lot. I talked to Brad Parrott, crew chief for Juan Pablo Montoya, just before we went green today, and he said the biggest thing that Juan does really good is run long distances. But the fact that they've only got 36 in last year, he's hoping they get a lot more than that today.
Montoya running in sixth place right now. There's the lead that Johnny Sauter has opened up on second place. 88 is Shane Huffman. That's the car owned by Dale Earnhardt Jr. And Jason Keller slots in third, but trying to get second away.
Jason Keller looks like he's going to take a look on the inside of that 88 car, and he's going to get down beside him and take that spot away. Jason Keller will take the second spot. Lindsay, what's he saying on the radio?
Well, Jason Keller had talked to me before this race saying that he was shocked that they actually qualified so well. In fact, he was upset with the tire choice they had made for qualifying. He was so concerned about it last night that he called his wife and said, I don't know what I should do. His wife said, you have to trust your crew chief Newt Moore's decision. So he said, okay, we'll let it go. They went with stickers today, and you see how it's done. But so far, he's steady, guys.
Well, if it's Newt Moore, I'd be worried, too. No, just kidding. Just kidding, Newt.
I knew there was a singer coming there. You had that look in your
face. Yeah, well, I worked with Newt a few years back, and now Newt Moore's a racer, and that's good that Keller's getting an opportunity here because it's a really good driver that hasn't had an opportunity in the last couple of years.
Kevin Harvick trying to lead the charge of the Cup drivers up in the back. He's in 25th on board Stephen Wallace. Stephen just passed by Harvick and got Bowyer there in the two trying to come up through him. Montoya making a move.
Montoya's going to take that fifth spot away.
And that's from Willie Allen, driver in the 14 car, track champion of the Music City Motorplex.
Easy for you to say.
I rehearsed that all night, too.
And, you know, this is a good place for Montoya to be. I mean, he's up front. It's single filed out. You know, he's around good cars. This is a good opportunity to get some experience and not being, you know, back in the pack right now where these guys are racing side by side and a little bit crazy back there sometimes.
So Montoya to fifth up front. Johnny Sauter's checked out a little bit from second place. Driver who started on pole got the early lead here in Memphis Motorsports Park. You're watching NASCAR on NBC. If you're not watching the race on a Sony high-definition TV, what are you watching? NASCAR on NBC with the NASCAR Busch Series today from Memphis Motorsports Park. Green flag so far through the opening 21 laps. Johnny Sauter in double zero is the race leader.
He is smoking around this place right now, and he's already starting to lap cars. And tell you what, if this thing goes green much longer, Ralph, he's going to be looking at some of those Cup guys just ahead of him.
Doubt about it, Wally. And as you know, no race car driver is ever satisfied with the quality of his car. And even though Sauter's double zero is now starting to stretch its legs out over Keller and working his way through the back half of the field, his car is still not exactly where he wants it. He's searching for a little bit more bite coming up off the corner.
There's a bunch of other guys screaming that.
Yeah.
His car, if he's complaining about his car, just think about what everybody else going gets.
Now, here are some of the guys that Johnny Sauter's coming up on very quickly. You got the 9 car, red one on the right of the screen. That's Casey Kane. First laps he's turned in this car all weekend when this race started. Yesterday in Atlanta, when the next hour, Reed Sorensen there.
And overheating right there. So he will be probably coming into pit lane pretty soon if that thing's blowing out water right now.
Yesterday, the Nextel Cup Series drivers were scheduled to be in Atlanta to practice and qualify. It rained there all day. A number of them jumped on an airplane and came up here to Memphis, where they were able to get some practice in between some of the rain showers. Kane was not one of them. These are his first laps in this car all weekend at the start of this race.
And that's tough. I mean, that's really tough. You've got somebody else driving your car, setting it up. No two drivers like the exact same setup. Everybody's got a little bit different feel. And so that's pretty difficult. Casey's, you know, obviously trying to get a feel for this thing. And I'm sure we'll be making a lot of changes or some changes on their first pit stop.
First visit to pit road comes from Peyton Sellers. Driving for Ted Marsh out of Connecticut. Sellers, former NASCAR National Short Track Champion. In his second ever Busch Series start. That's an early pit stop for him. So here's the part that I'm intrigued about is as Sauter begins to close up on these guys. You got Kane back here in 32nd place. A couple spots ahead of him, Sorensen in 30th. A couple spots ahead of him, Carl Edwards in 28th. And there's the distance.
Yeah, and like I said, I'm sure Casey Kane wants to get in and make some adjustments on that car. So he's praying for a yellow right now so he doesn't go lap down because I'm, you know, first time in the car, like you said. What is he saying, Ralph?
I'll tell you right now, he's picked up 12 positions since the start of this race, but he's loose in and off, but he's turning pretty good through the center of the corner. And Wally, that's really the key. You got to get through the center of the corner, and this is a racetrack that's really all about momentum.
Thing is, the guy in the double zero's got more than he has right now, so
yeah.
He is going to be lapped really quick if this thing stays green. See Sauter right there. Lapping the 35th place car, or trying to right there, Regan Smith. And he's picking them off about one car lap right now. He's putting guys down.
Here's the guy I'm keeping my eye on, Wally. Clint Bowyer just passed his teammate Kevin Harvick for 14th place. Last year, Clint Bowyer started this race in 35th place, remember?
Yep.
And went up and dominated the second half of this thing.
Yep, yep. He definitely had that thing figured out, and he is looking pretty good right now. That car looks like it did last year. It stays on the bottom. It doesn't move around. It looks like it's got a lot of grip.
So Bowyer, the farthest forward of the Cup guys, charging from the back. Meantime, Johnny Sauter still out front by nearly 4 seconds as he works on catching up with the likes of Casey Kane and some others to try and put him a lap down. 31 of 250 laps complete. Wisconsin's Johnny Sauter out in front. The NASCAR Busch Series in the Samstown 250 from Memphis on NBC Sports. Tomorrow, the Nextel Cup Series from Atlanta Motor Speedway as the chase for the Cup continues. Johnny Sauter out in front by 4.5 seconds over Jason Keller, really working some thick and heavy lap traffic.
And doing well. There's Montoya right behind a bunch of traffic.
That's a race for third, fourth, and fifth just ahead of him. 88 Shane Huffman in third, 22 Kenny Wallace in fourth, and then Montoya in the 42 in fifth. I talked with Juan Pablo yesterday and asked him what would be a good day at Memphis for you today.
You know, if I can stay in the lead lap and do the pit stop, stop in the marks, and go through the process, if I can race people cleanly, and if I can get, you know, if I can finish in the lead lap, I'll be more than happy.
That's a good goal. I mean, you know, because these pit stops are nothing like he's used to.
Yeah.
I mean, not even close. It's like stepping back in time 25 years compared to, you know, a Formula One pit stop.
Yeah, if you're not familiar with Formula One racing, where Montoya has come from, they'll have about 50 guys around the car, and it takes them about 8 seconds to change four tires and refuel the thing with this pressurized fueling rig and all that. It's a little different on pit road here in NASCAR land, huh, Ralph?
It is, Alan, and one of the things we're hearing from all the teams is tight in the center, loose off, and there's two reasons for that. One, we're now 41 laps into this race. Remember, last year we only went 36 laps, our longest green flag run. So these guys are building up a little bit of heat in the right front tire, and Wally, as you know, that's where you start to see that car pushing a little bit, and that's what they're struggling to balance. Plus, it's also the hottest it's been all weekend right now here in Memphis.
Yeah, what's happening? Cars are pushing, so they're putting a lot of steering wheel into the car, and the car won't turn. So if the car doesn't turn, you put more and more wheel in it. Well, when you're coming off the corner and the rear of the car finally catches up with it, that's when the cars get loose getting off, because you have so much wheel turned into it as you're getting off the corner. So, you know, there'll be a lot of wrenches flying on these first pit stops as far as, you know, trying to loosen these cars up a little bit.
Stephen Wallace, 64, driving for Papa Rusty, trying to pick up a spot. Bernie Lamar in the 77 there. That's back for 25th place. And this is where the leader, Johnny Sauter, is coming up behind this whole group that's racing side by side. See Casey Kane just out of glimpse, just behind these two. There's the red and white car of Kane. That's Justin Labonte in the 5, subbing for Kyle Busch in the Hendrick Motorsports car this weekend. Kyle choosing not to make the trip across to Memphis. And up front, the lead car's in some heavy lap traffic, too. How about Jason Keller running second, Lindsay?
Jason Keller told me right before this race that he knows this is his last chance.
We got
trouble.
Hang on, Lindsay. 77 car is around. I don't think he hit anything. Possibly he got hit.
I did. There we go. That's what I was thinking.
Yep.
First caution of the race, lap 45. And Casey Kane was just in front of the leader when that caution came out.
Was Casey Kane close to him?
Yeah, might have been. What are you thinking?
Not thinking anything. Yeah, I guess I was thinking about that. All right, you got the leaders in your mirror, Casey. And I bet there's some contact here.
Oops.
A caution of convenience?
Wow.
Check up, check up, check up. You're all good. Caution's out, caution's out.
Well then.
You're all good.
Not that anybody would ever do anything like that on purpose.
Yeah. Well, on purpose or not, what is that? Wow. That was under the yellow flag as the field bunched up just a second ago. They got away with that.
What?
What?
See, I have brake problems.
Yeah. Okay. Little tiny bit of damage there on the hood of the Everham Motorsports number 9. So everybody will be on pit road here. All 28 that are on the lead lap. John Wood is the lucky dog here under this caution. And Johnny Sauter's team gets a chance to try and hold the lead for their man. Last year, everybody stopped 3 times. There was no tire strategy, things like that, shuffle and track position. The whole field stopped together 3 times, and it was heads up for the pit crews and heads up for the drivers on the track. None of the strategy shuffle going on. All right, Lindsay, here's Jason Keller.
Jason Keller in the 66 car said the only way he would come down is if Johnny Sauter did. So here is Jason Keller. Keller, who said that he knows this is his last chance because this is his last Busch race of the season. He will take 4 tires and fuel. Next door in the number 88, Shane Huffman. Shane Huffman said he was so shocked that his car qualified well. His team, too, 4 tires and fuel. To Ralph.
Well, the double zero pit crew of Johnny Johnny Sauter, one of the best in the business in the Busch Series. They clinched the 2006 Checkers Rally's Pit Challenge earlier this year with 9 wins. They're going to try to get this car a little bit better for them. They went a half round up on the track bar and a half pound out of the right rear. Still trying to get this car dialed in, Alan.
Sauter's crew holds the lead on the first set of pit stops under yellow at lap 47 here in Memphis. Just back under the green flag, NASCAR Busch Series Racing presented by Propane from Memphis Motorsports Park. Johnny Sauter is the race leader after the pit stops. And trouble, turn 4. That'll be a big one. Is that Kevin Harvick in the middle of it? No, it's the other Childress car, Timothy Peters.
Yeah, I don't think he really hit anything. I don't think any of those guys really hit anything hard.
Let's see, there's Denny Hamlin in the 20.
They're still coming up to speed, so that probably saved a lot of them.
Cale Gayle in the 33 for Kevin Harvick's team. I don't think Hamlin got any big damage there. Well, rough afternoon there for Jerry Robertson.
Looks like Jerry Robertson got into the 56 car. Shandell, I think. Yeah, and that just blocked the racetrack.
Twist on Memphis traffic jam. This is Stephen Wallace.
Stop. Oh! 99 car didn't stop. Is that 99 then?
Yeah.
Joey Miller.
Driving for Michael Waltrip. Clunk. And that's not good. Harvick was just in front of it.
Yeah.
Wow.
He was beside it.
Yep.
Actually, 56 car looked like it almost got into his left rear.
Keselowski around. Kane stops right behind it.
Yeah, watch Harvick on the high side. 56 gets a little bit tagged there.
He took a little hit.
Yeah, just a little bit on the left rear wheel.
Joey Miller on pit road. Tim Schendel's on pit road. Justin Labonte's on pit road. By the way, Ashton Lewis took his car to the garage just before that restart. And the caution flag is out. Second time, didn't take long after the first one. NASCAR Busch Series Racing from Memphis is brought to you by Energizer. Keep going. By Miller Lite, for great taste, there's no debate. Miller Lite, always a good call. And by Sony. Sony, the official high-definition television of NASCAR on NBC. Green flag just back in the air with Johnny Sauter, the race leader. And that big jam of traffic behind him with trouble lurking.
Wow, Paul Menard, 11 car, trying to get underneath Kenny Wallace. Kenny Wallace looked like he put a pretty good block on him going down the straightaway. Got the 2 car back there looking under Montoya in the 42. Wow, there's not much room down there.
Flint Boyer charging to the front in that 2. Still a lot of these Nextel Cup guys that started in the back trying to sift their way through. Look at that jam. The way these Busch Series races have been this year, whenever I see a pack of traffic like that, it spells one thing.
Trouble?
Yeah.
Wow, here we go. 3 wide off of 4. That's Hamlin in the middle.
Jay Sauter underneath in the 0-1. Hamlin has not been happy with the way his car's been running all weekend. He's one of the guys that came up here yesterday for practice and just did not like, whoop, there we go. Caution flag is out, I believe I mentioned the word trouble before.
Wow.
That is Carlos Contreras in the 12 for Fitz Bradshaw Racing.
Looks so promising the first 42 laps.
Contreras, the 36-year-old from Mexico City, former regular in the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series. Let's see what's cooking here. Left side of the screen.
He's going to get tagged in the left rear by the 4 car of Augie Vidovich.
Now, that's twice that these turn four wrecks have happened right in front of Clint Bowyer in the two. So if he gets through this day unscathed and ends up at the front of the pack, he's going to have had his share of frights. That's an appropriate thing before Halloween, isn't it?
Very nice.
Tomorrow night at 8 Eastern on NBC, Keyshawn Johnson faces his former team for the first time since being released by Dallas in the offseason. And before the big game, catch up on all the day's NFL action with Football Night in America, Sunday night, 7 Eastern. That's tomorrow on NBC. Carolina-Dallas should be a pretty good game. Here in Memphis, getting ready to go back racing shortly. After the third caution of the race waved, none for the first 46 laps. And now three cautions in 14 laps. Denny Hamlin was on pit road under the yellow. Lindsay?
Yeah, Denny Hamlin just came back down here again, not exactly having the kind of day that he wants. He had some front fender damage is what they were trying to fix. So they brought him in, they thought it was all right, brought him back in, sent him out, hoping that they were able to fix the damage.
Hamlin wasn't having the kind of day he wanted to start with down in Atlanta either. Earlier today, practicing his Nextel Cup car did not go to his liking in the first practice. The plan was to run the first of the two scheduled practices, get on the plane and come here. So stayed for the first part of the second practice, and there was some concern as to whether he was going to make the start of this race on time. He did.
Yeah, barely.
But now...
And Atlanta's one of those places where you want the car to be comfortable. You are flying around that racetrack, so if the car's not handling well, it's probably best to stay a little bit longer to try to get it worked out.
Report was, talked to Marty Snyder earlier, report was that they got the car better at the start of that second practice, so some optimism there for Hamlin as he chases the championship. And we look to see if we can chase a few more green flag laps here than three cautions in 14. Racing didn't really get a chance to talk about it, but on the sets of pit stops, the Nextel Cup-based teams, Richard Childress Racing for Kevin Harvick and Clint Bowyer, and Joe Gibbs Racing for J.J. Yeadon, those guys picked up a lot of ground on that set of pit stops.
Yeah, the pit stop, those guys look like they gained about 10 positions in the pits, notably the 21 car. So those guys did a great job on their pit stop, and hey, you pass them the way you can. If you can get them in the pits, that's great.
Second place here, 22, Kenny Wallace, and 66, Jason Keller. The four car of Marky Vinovich is the first car one lap down in 31st place.
Yeah, and that 66 car, Jason Keller, wants to keep him down on that bottom. He doesn't want Kenny Wallace to get in there. Now Kenny Wallace gets down on the bottom. And wow, Harvick had to slam on the brakes, which allowed the 11 car, Paul Menard, to get up on the outside of him. So right now, that four car is causing fits with the leaders. Now they all get through. So
Bowyer, three deep on the bottom in the two car.
And the four car is trying to stay up there to be the lucky dog in case the yellow comes out. So he can't just back off and let those guys go. And we got stuff going on all over the racetrack.
Clear.
Clear.
Lindsay, we're still under green.
And said, tell Johnny that the storm is coming. You guys know that he loves this track, partly because he's so obsessed with Elvis. Bully, you've had obsessions like that, right?
Yeah, not with Elvis, though, but I know there's a few of those guys.
Right.
You see Paul Menard down there with those sideburns. He's got an obsession with Elvis.
Yeah.
But the two car is hooked up, and we talked about it earlier, Alan. I mean, he flew around this place last year. The car just looks like it's got so much grip as he passes Kevin Harvick, which not many people have done this year.
Yeah, all year.
And driving away.
Talked to Bowyer yesterday in the garage area and asked him if you had one bit of advice to give Juan Pablo Montoya about his first Busch Series race here at Memphis, what would it be?
At this track in Memphis, keep it on the bottom and stay out of the way.
I love his sense of humor.
Yeah.
He is a lot of fun, and he's fast right now. Bowyer going to work on Kenny Wallace here for third place. It Last year at this race, Wally, I'm sure you remember this, but on qualifying day, the qualifying run, which was before the race, his first lap was great. His second lap, he spun out and crashed.
Right.
And so they had to literally, in the short time between qualifying and the race, take the car back to the garage and rebuild it. He started at the back of the field, worked his way up through, actually got involved in a little skirmish on pit road, had to go to the back of the field again on the first pit stop, and just after halfway took the lead and led all but a couple of the last 100 and change laps of the race.
Yeah, well, it's just, you know, if you watch the front of the car, that's what I really noticed on that two car, is how when he gets down on the bottom of the racetrack, it's like I said, it just sticks, it turns, and he can run lower than anybody out there, especially after these guys get some laps on their tires. So, yeah, Johnny Sauter may have some company here if this thing stays green.
Pretty solid day for Kenny Wallace, Ralph. He's in fifth.
Well, Kenny Wallace has just dropped from third to fifth, Allen, but he's still basking in the glow of a World Series victory for his beloved St. Louis Cardinals. Kenny was a little frustrated when he saw on the schedule that he was going to be here in Memphis while the Cardinals were still playing the World Series, been a season ticket holder for quite a while. Well, he took an $8,000 bullet bite, jumped on a private plane, and flew to St. Louis to be there last night as his team won the World Series. As soon as it was over, he ordered stickers to get placed on his race car and headed for the locker room, claimed a bottle of champagne and got a paper before he got back on the plane to head back here. When he reached Memphis, it was 2 a.m.
And well worth it.
Yep.
Every penny and every minute of lost sleep. It's good stuff. Kenny and his team hoping to put on a good performance today. The sponsor on their car, this is their home area. And of course, that team needing sponsorship for next year. J.J. Yaley, speaking of hometown sponsors, if you've never been to Memphis before, when you fly into the Memphis airport, it's hard to miss that FedEx logo because that's their big base where they do all the swap of the cargo that's changing planes on overnight runs and things. So this is a huge race for the Joe Gibbs team, and Yaley carrying the FedEx colors here for the team today and having a good run.
Yeah, absolutely. Up to sixth spot right there, overtaking Paul Menard. So Yaley has got a good ride today here in Memphis.
What's he saying, Lindsay?
He's not saying much. He's actually being very, very quiet, which his crew says is a pretty good thing. But JJ absolutely loves his track because he got his second place finish here last year, and that ties his career best in the Busch Series. So he thinks if he can go into Atlanta tomorrow with the momentum of a win today, JJ Yaley's going to be a very happy man.
Box on the upper left, Clint Bowyer taking second place from Jason Keller.
So that puts Bowyer only about a second behind the leader of Johnny Sauter, so it should get interesting.
You know, the last time Johnny Sauter led a NASCAR Busch Series race before today, this race 1 year ago, and it was Clint Bowyer that passed him to take that lead away.
My kids call me the finisher.
Finish up in there.
Okay.
Finish your homework?
Yes.
Finish your vegetables. Something I thought I was finished with? Managing my acid reflux disease. I thought it was just bad heartburn, but my doctor said over time, stomach acid was damaging the lining of my esophagus. She prescribed Nexium, said I needed more than heartburn relief. My esophagus needed repair. One prescription Nexium pill a day not only relieves my heartburn, it healed erosions in my esophagus. So I don't just feel better, I am better. My doctor did say headache, diarrhea, and abdominal pain could be side effects of Nexium, and other serious stomach conditions may still exist.
Talk to your doctor about Nexium, the healing purple pill, and find out if a free trial is right for you.
I tell him you shouldn't do anything halfway. Let's finish up.
If you're without prescription coverage and can't afford your medication, AstraZeneca may be able to help.
I live for speed.
You're running on empty. You gotta be in it for the long haul. Now that guy has the right idea. Let's keep going, buddy.
Look for special savings from Energizer on Cars DVD at participating retailers. Rated G.
Raindrops keep falling on my head.
Right now at Advance, all wiper blades are 25% off. And as always, we install them fast and free. Yeah, free.
So, what kind of financial help are you looking for? Maybe you need insurance to help protect you. benefits to help your business reach new heights. Or a retirement plan to invest for the future. Then again, maybe there's someone who can help with all of those things. The Principal Financial Group will give you an edge.
Hi, I'm Hugh Laurie, and I'm hosting SNL this week with Beck.
This is my first time.
This is my sixth.
Be gentle with me.
The NASCAR.com Superstore. Everything you need except the bridal registry.
We should have never let the guys pick the gifts.
Get to it and other exclusive NASCAR content at AOL and NASCAR.com.
NASCAR Busch Series Racing from Memphis, presented by Propane on NBC. New leader of the race, first lead change of the day.
And look at the gap you already put on Johnny Sauter.
Clint Boyer.
Yep, takes the lead and driving away.
Happened just a couple laps ago, down in turn one.
Just smoked it down in there underneath Johnny. Johnny knew he was coming. Gave him enough room. And I mean, when, you know, Johnny Sauter, he's been around this a long time. You know, he looks up in the mirror and sees that car coming, and he just knew that, you know, why race him? He's going to catch me that fast and go. I just can't wait to get back in there and adjust my car some more. What do you got, Ralph?
Well, I just spoke to competition director Billy Engel for the 00 team, and I said, did you guys have a plan for this day? Because they kept talking about it over and over on the radio. He said, yeah, we knew the Cup guys would be coming from the tail end of the field. They're all fast, and that eventually they probably would catch us and pass us. But we're not worried about that. We want to actually see what they've got and then adjust our car accordingly. So they know they've got a long race. We're only 88 laps into this thing. They know they can dial their car to catch up to Boyer and the rest and maybe retake that lead at the end.
I tell you, they're going to have to do some serious dialing.
I'm thinking the same thing. They better have a lot of dialing, because right now the two car is flying. Who's Carl Edwards? Yep. Underneath the 42 car, you see Montoya pointing out the window. Go ahead. Stay down low, and I'll give it to you.
So Carl up to eighth spot. Montoya back to ninth. Still very respectable so far. And Edwards, another one of those charging from the back. And again, picked up some spots on the pit stop. Was in danger of going a lap down early. Got a caution. One of his fellow Cup drivers helping with that.
Yeah. And I think it was key for these guys to get into pits and make some adjustments. I mean, when you're starting back here like that, you're just hanging on for the first caution so you can get in there and get the car where you like it. Now they're all the Cup guys are running pretty good right now.
This racetrack is the same size as the track in Richmond, but the drivers tell you it's not anything close, the way that it drives, the way that it feels.
Well, if you watch these cars, especially going into turn three, there's some bumps back on this racetrack. You watch the front of the cars, you get right in here, the track is real wavy, but it's not like Richmond, to the fact that this place is a little bit wider corner-wise. I mean, Richmond's got a flatter one and two, but it's a fun racetrack. All these guys really like it. You know, you roll down into the corner, you roll off the gas, get a little brake on there, get off the brake as fast as you can, let the car roll through the center, start picking up the throttle. It's not a real hard track to drive.
But there's no place to relax.
No, well, basically it's a short track.
Yeah.
Clear.
So Carl right now in seventh place, working on Kenny Wallace for sixth. And Edwards in that fight for second place in the NASCAR Busch Series Championship.
You see Kenny pointing out the window, giving them the inside. And like I said, there again, Kenny realizes these guys are coming up. They're faster than he is right now. There's no sense of racing them. Wait till we get in the pits. We'll make adjustments, then go race them.
Kevin Harvick, J.J. Yaley, third place here. Harvick in 21, Yaley in 18. Working around the lap car, the 70 machine. That's Justin Dirks.
Yaley's trying to take it away from Harvick. He's got him on the outside now. We'll see the run out of room. That 70 car may come into play. Justin Dirks, he's down on the bottom now. Harvick slides up.
Is he going to lean on him? A little nudge there.
Yaley's going to take that spot. Jason Keller right there in the 66 car.
you were to put a graph of J.J. Yaley's Busch Series finishes this season on a piece of paper, it looked like a roller coaster. Up and down and up and down, looking for that first win. He's going to have to outrun this very fast car today. Clint Boyer in command here in Memphis.
To those who say NASCAR isn't a sport, they may be right. It's a way of life. Busch Beer. For 25 years running, proud sponsor of the NASCAR Busch Series.
This renovation is so energy efficient.
Oh, really?
Yeah, double insulated windows, low flow faucets, propane appliances, like that tankless water heater.
My room is going to be really great. I can see it now.
What's your fireplace doing in my dream room?
Just warming it up. For me? Thanks.
Looking to build, buy, or renovate? Look to energy efficient propane at usepropane.com.
We just come out back at Memphis Motorsports Park. Stephen Wallace is tangled with Timothy Peters in yellow flag number 4 at lap number 99. And tangled with may be the right description here.
Yeah, Timothy Peters in the 29 car did not leave Stephen Wallace too much room when he was down there.
Or didn't know he was there.
But regardless, Stephen Wallace just ran out of room. He was there. And then the 29 car just kept coming down the racetrack.
Lock it down here.
Regardless.
All right, you're all clear.
Leaders are on pit road. Lindsay?
J.J. Yaley was feeling pretty good about his car, so they brought it in. They're going to give him 2 right sides, put on some left sides, too, as you see them doing there. He had gotten on before saying, guys, I feel very, very comfortable. Just keep it up. Next door in the 2 car, we're hearing the Clint Boyer is about to pull into a stop. We'll see when he gets here, guys.
The double zero is in. This is the first race for new crew chief Booty Barker. They've decided to put a half pound less in the right front, and they're also trying to work on increasing that forward grip for the double zero. That's what they think, Alan, is going to help them reel back in the 2 of Clint Boyer.
Need something, because Boyer class of the field so far in the middle stages of this race. He holds the lead off the pit stops here in Memphis. NBC Sports live at Memphis Motorsports Park. NASCAR Busch Series Racing presented by Propane under caution number 4 in this race. And the leaders have all made their second round of pit stops. FreeCreditReport.com pit summary. Everybody holding serve except for J.J. Yaley. Kevin Harvick squeezed out ahead of him. Well, let's see if the adjustments that Sauter's team made to his car lets him hang with Boyer a little bit here. Feels like deja vu.
Yeah.
The way that the 2 cars run.
I think Sauter's car is pretty good. Seemed like it's been really good after a pit stop, but where Boyer's car really shines is when these guys have been under green for a while.
Boyer, Sauter, Harvick, Yaley, Edwards, then Menard, Kenny Wallace, Jason Leffler, and Pablo Montoya, and Jason Keller are in the top 10. Leaders get around the lap cars on the inside line really well. Fired, made a pit stop for repairs. He's back in 35th place.
Wow.
And
Here's Casey Kane.
Get low.
Right in front of him, and now behind him. 36 car, one of the Sauter brothers, Tim. And the yellow flag is out again. That would be number five. And it's way too early to start talking about.
Yeah, let's not even bring it up.
Record numbers of cautions and things like that. But do you remember what the number is for most cautions in a Busch Series race this year?
I remember we were there. I don't remember what the number was.
All right, I'll give you a minute to think about it.
It had to be more than 12.
Yeah, it was more than 12. Quite a bit. Hopefully we don't get that far today. We had some good racing while we've been under green.
Yeah, we did. I'm pretty sure Tim Sauter got some help. If you look at his left rear underneath the bumper, it's pretty much gone. So that's a good indication that somebody turned him.
Caution's out, pace car's out. We'll take a break. Clint Bowyer, the race leader at lap 107 of 250. Green flag just back in the air at Memphis Motorsports Park with Clint Bowyer, the leader. Johnny Sauter second, Kevin Harvick third, J.J. Yaley fourth, Carl Edwards fifth. Four of those five started at the tail end of the field because somebody else qualified their car this morning while they were in Atlanta practicing their Nextel Cup machines for tomorrow's 500 mile. Progress report on the top 10 as we approach halfway through this race. We go through the field and start with the leader in Lindsay.
Clint Bowyer is heavily right out front. He just said, we got to give it a dirt track feel all the way, guys. On their last stop, they did give Clint four tires fuel, and he told me this morning he feels like he has the car to take it all the way. Ralph?
Well, Lindsay, the double zero of Johnny Sauter is back to second. He says the toughest part in catching the two of Clint Bowyer is the fact that the two car is very good from where he's sitting from the center of the corner off. And his car's not as good in that position just yet. However, his pit crew is very strong. That last stop of 14.3. So one of the Busch regular crews matching that at the best of the Cup cars. Now, as far as Kevin Harvick goes, his car is struggling to turn from the center off. However, they've gone up a half a pound in the right rear. And they figure, Lindsay, they probably have two more stops to keep adjusting on it.
J.J. Yaley in the 18 car finally feels like he's gotten it to do what he wants. Because he was saying before it was a little bit tight. He is still looking to surpass that second place finish that we told you he had your last year. Right behind Yaley is number 60, Carl Edwards. And Carl, here's a fun fact for you. He was fit in the last three starts he's had here. He desperately wants to break that chain. Ralph?
Paul Menard is running in sixth place in car number 11. This is his 100th Busch start. However, his car just will not turn in the center at all. It's all bound up on the exit as well. So he's really struggling with that 11 right now. Kenny Wallace in the 22 took four tires of fuel. The car seems to be good for about 20 to 30 laps. And then the left front tire just goes away completely, Lindsay.
66 of Jason Keller. Obviously not where he wanted to be after he started the race so strong. Keller told me he knows this is his very last chance. He's got to wash away a season of disappointment by getting a win today. Next up behind Keller, we have Jason Leffler. Leffler just came on the radio, said, I'm feeling very tight in, loose off. They're trying to find a happy balance, hopefully doing it without having to bring him back in. And right behind Leffler is Montoya. And guys, I have to tell you, his crew has basically been babying Montoya all race long. They've been saying after restarts, when we say green, we mean go. They're taking their time. They're really working on communication with Montoya. Alan and Wally?
It's a lot to learn.
Yeah, there is a lot to learn.
And I'd be curious to see what he says about his pit stops afterwards. Remember he talked about getting used to making pit stops this way, so many cars on pit road at once, that kind of thing. Be curious to get his feedback later about what that was like and what he feels like he can do better there or needs to learn there. So far, all the fenders are in one piece. Montoya runs 10th. Clint Bowyer runs first by 0.8 of a second over Johnny Sauter. NASCAR Busch Series Racing from Memphis is brought to you by New York Life, the company you keep. By the U.S. Navy, Navy, accelerate your life. And by Reese's Peanut Butter Cups with caramel. Sixth caution of the race is out. Little loop off of turn number two by Stephen Light just a couple of seconds ago.
Yeah, looks like he just had to check up a little bit for the 31 car, or is that Cleaver maybe in the 06?
Yep.
Regardless, whoever it was got in his left rear and turned him around. That's the 31 car that turned him around.
Yeah, he got clipped on the right front, too, by the 06. He got it coming and going.
Other than that, he would have made it.
Yeah. No problem. So, pace car out in front of the field. Don't expect to see any pit stops from the leaders under this caution. Been talking a lot about Juan Pablo Montoya, running back in 10th place, making his NASCAR racing debut. Star-studded career for this young man. Came up through the open wheel ranks, was the CART Open Wheel Series champion in 99, the Indy 500 winner in 2000, then headed off to Europe to the Formula One World Championship Circuit. 7 wins, including a win at Monaco. Decided this past July he was coming NASCAR racing. Made his stock car debut with a third place finish at Talladega Super Speedway in October. Ran an ARCA race at Iowa Speedway a couple of weeks ago. And now here he is in his NASCAR debut at Memphis.
Looks like he's got a little damage here in the right front since we saw him last.
Yep. That'll hurt a little bit. So Montoya running back in, again, 10th place for now. Let's check on the second place running car with Ralph.
Booty Barker, the new crew chief for Johnny Sauter. Booty, you guys have said that you had a plan all day long, that you could dial this car and you weren't worried about the cup guys coming through the field. You still comfortable with that?
Absolutely. The 2 and the 21 have been dominant all year, so if you're running with them, you're in the hunt. We hadn't made any really long runs yet, so I don't want to make any mistakes and get them too tight. So Johnny in a yellow transportation Chevrolet is being smooth as silk, and we're going to be in good shape.
Lindsay?
Dan Deeringhall is the crew chief for Clint Bowyer. Dan, last year, Clint worked all of the way from 35th up to win the race. Now he's already made it back to first stop from the back of the field. Is he going to be able to stay up there?
Clint's saying the Ace Delco Chevrolet is as good as it was last year. So all we can do is hope that we have the same outcome.
Dan, he's had such a rat race of going from Atlanta back here to Memphis, back to Atlanta, back here. How does this affect him for tomorrow's race even?
As long as we're running good, it's a good effect for him, I think. If we're having a bad day, maybe some of that carries in. But right now, everything's looking good for both days.
Right. Dan Deeringhoff, Clint Bowyer's crew chief, wants to get his driver his second Busch Series win. Upstairs.
Just crossed halfway, Lindsay, and we are still under caution, so let's step out. Bowyer in command of the Samstown 250. You're watching NASCAR on NBC. Tomorrow, Nextel Cup Racing from Atlanta, presented by the Home Depot. We start at 2:30 Eastern Time with Bank of America, countdown to green. Closest championship since this chase was formed at this point in the year. The way Martinsville turned things inside out last week, what a race this is going to be for these final 4 weeks.
It did. It mixed it up, and it brought all those guys a bunch closer. This guy's flat out, yeah. Just so everybody knows.
That's what the delay was in getting back to green. They were trying to sweep some of the debris off the racetrack, and I think it had one speed.
Slow.
Yeah. I was thinking about Jimmy Johnson and how fortunes have turned. The first few races in the chase for the Nextel Cup looked like he was out of it, had his misfortune, and all of a sudden a second and a first back-to-back.
Yeah, it's like, you know, you think about it. It's like, well, if you have a bad race or a DNF, it's going to be really tough to climb out of that hole because, you know, normally somebody doesn't have problems. Everybody's had problems so far during the chase.
And I think what's happened is the Nextel Cup chase has turned from a race where somebody could lose it by having bad days to where now somebody can go win it. Yep. You know, Johnson or Kane or Kenseth, one of these guys is going to run off 3 top 5 finishes in these last 4 races,
right,
and go out and win the championship versus just not having problems in other guys that other guys do. One to go. So we're racing here in a half a lap. Clint Bowyer out in front, followed by Johnny Sauter, Kevin Harvick, J.J. Yealey, and Carl Edwards. And you've got Paul Menard in 6th, Kenny Wallace 7th, Jason Keller 8th, Jason Leffler 9th, and Juan Pablo Montoya
in 10th position. A lot of guys on the lead lap. 29, Augie Vidovich, the lucky dog on this caution in the four car. So he's back on the lead lap in that 29th place.
Just going to accordion right on down the back. I can't believe everybody got through that without clobbering each other. My first three cars clear, slower traffic, which is important. You get hung up on the outside of a slower car here, you lose a lot of time to the leaders.
And there's Harvick in third. And by the way, just where championships are concerned, talking about Harvick, how he clinched the driver's championship in Charlotte. But because Harvick was driving his own car, the Kevin Harvick Incorporated car, Richard Childress has not clinched the NASCAR Busch Series owner's championship yet. But he'll likely do that today as long as Harvick, driving that 21 today, finishes 35th or better. He just wanted all kind of neat and sewn up, you know, team, driver, get everybody holding the same trophy, you know, I mean, come on. And something else I think needs to be mentioned when we talk about all these Nextel Cup guys that were in Atlanta and shuttling back and forth and so on. The substitute drivers that helped set up and practice and qualify their cars. Looking at Harvick here, two-time Busch Series champ Randy LaJoie stepped in and qualified this car for Harvick and did about half the practicing in it yesterday. And
he qualified well, didn't he? Qualified fifth.
Yeah, and LaJoie is literally, he's looking for a job. You know, former two-time series champ, but he's one of these guys stepping in, trying to get in a good piece of equipment, show what he can do.
And there's a classic example of a guy that can still do it.
Yeah.
I mean, jumped in the car. You know, the car's running and set up wise. He's running third right now. He qualified fifth, not being in the car that much this year. So, I mean, yeah, these guys haven't forgotten how to drive race cars. Just the equipment makes a big difference here in NASCAR. And, you know, it's good. Randy jumped in. It's just like Jason Keller, you know, jumps in the 66, and he's giving that car a great ride. It's hard to carry one of these cars. They're bad when they're good, handling wise.
Sloppy. So Harvick running third, behind Sauter by about 0.4 of a second, and behind this guy, Clint Bowyer, by about a tenth, one second and 1/10.
Oh, wow.
Trouble.
Cars all over the place. There's Mike Wallace in the one car.
That's turn two. Casey Atwood in the 27 is the other car sitting there. Did Casey Kane get a piece of that, too?
No, with the 12 car. But he got a piece of it.
Let's see what we can see here. Who's behind Casey?
The 72 car spun. DJ Kennington, and then everybody else just kind of was trying to avoid it.
Yeah, let this be a better look. Yep, bumper cars in the jam up. Denny Hamlin. That's, what, three today he's been right in the middle of?
Not sure what happened, why the 12 car sitting over in turn three, I believe.
Yeah, this is in turn two.
Well, these guys kind of got away without too much damage.
And there's the Carlos Contreras car, and we're trying to figure out what happened to him. We'll keep digging on it. Pit road's closed. We're under caution at Memphis. Sunoco NASCAR race points. Every 10-gallon fill-up earns you 200 race points. Good toward good NASCAR rewards. During the Chase for the Cup, every race point you earn is a chance to win the Chase for the Race Points sweepstakes. Get your race points at Sunoco today. Go to NASCAR.com or a participating Sunoco location for details. Pit road closed. They've got the rescue vehicle sitting out there in turn three by where the Carlos Contreras car still sits, being attended to. Still under yellow here in Memphis. Back in Memphis, they have removed the Carlos Contreras car from the back straightaway. Pit road is open, and much to my disbelief, here come the leaders again.
I'm amazed.
I didn't think this would happen this quickly. They were last in at lap 100. It's only lap 142, Lindsay.
And you're right, lap 142, here comes Clint Bowyer. Bowyer will take four tires and fuel. Loves the car, happy obviously with their position. He has one Elvis statue he gave to his dad, wants to win this one and keep it for his own mantle. Ralph?
Well, at first, Moody Barker had told Johnny Sauter, only pit if the two pits. And then about a lap or so ago, he decided, no, you know what, come in anyway. So that's what they're doing. They've come in, they're going to take a half pound out of the right rear and get Johnny Sauter back out. Lindsay.
J.J. Yaley just came down, and Yaley was complaining. He felt like possibly the car was overheating. So what they did was check to see if there was anything in his grill, gave him four tires and fuel. Wally and Allen?
I mean, they can make it from here if they want.
On fuel, but no, yeah. I mean, okay, if the race goes clean from here to the finish.
Well, but when was the last time that happened?
Right, that's what I mean. Yeah, fuel is not the issue, but could they make it on tires?
Yeah.
This is the only look we have at what happened to Carlos Contreras. Look ahead from Jason Leffler's onboard, way up the front. Looks like he got clipped.
Yeah, there's something went on as the yellow or just after the caution came out. And he was all tore up. He is all tore up. And that happened way in front of the wreck.
So the 12 car back in the garage area. They continue to clean up out on the backstretch. A little pit strategy here is going to shut off the running order, but let's set the race for you as it's run to this point. Lap 47.
A little contact. Well, he really needed it, but, well, let's just move on. About to get lapped.
No cautions in the opening 47 laps of the race. Then we had three in 16 laps. There's Stephen Wallace in the 64, Timothy Peters in the 29.
Squeezed him down to the bottom a little bit too much. The 90 car, Stephen Light.
Got sandwiched. In turn two, that just a moment ago. Now the race off of pit road, won by car 21, Kevin Harvick.
Those guys have been smoking those pit stops all day long. They've been doing a good job down there in that 21 pit. So are these the Cup guys?
Yeah, this is Harvick's Nextel Cup pit crew. The guys that that normally pit him in the NASCAR Busch Series, I believe we're scheduled to work on the 29 car today of Timothy Peters.
Looks like the double zero got ahead, out ahead of the two cars as well.
So Bowyer back to third on his pit stop. That'll make it interesting.
Yeah, yeah.
But you got a couple guys that did not pit as well on the racetrack. As a matter of fact, five of them. Kenny Wallace will be the new leader. John Wood is second in that 47. Willie Allen, the 14 car, is third. That's a driver making his first ever Busch Series start. Track champion in Nashville this year. Todd Cleaver is fourth in the 06. And Augie Vinovich, fifth in the 4.
It could get messy.
You think?
Yeah, I think it's going to get messy. Looks like Kenny Wallace has got some damage here on that left rear of the 22 car. Sheet metal hanging out the side.
Got a little winglet going there.
Yeah.
I don't think I'd want to be the guy lined up to his inside.
Which is Stephen Wallace.
His nephew, yeah. Careful there, Steve. Steve's in a hurry. Just over 100 laps to go.
He just got caught last night.
Traffic and spun. Turn three. Caution flag is out. That hurts. Yaley in the top five up until the pit stop. And knocked around here. Let's see if we can find out what happened. You get nicked by Montoya there, maybe?
Yeah, it looks like it.
Where's he? I'm just out of the frame there on the right. Well, Yaley will come to pit road. Probably got some flat spots on those tires. And the caution flag is out again in Memphis. NASCAR Busch Series Racing from Memphis is brought to you by Propane, exceptional energy. By Smooth Busch Beer and easy drinking Busch Light. Busch, the proud sponsor of the NASCAR Busch Series, 25 years running. And by Yamaha ATVs, ain't nothing tougher than a Yamaha. Beautiful day here in Memphis, nice crisp fall afternoon. And a great crowd has turned out to watch the NASCAR Busch Series in their once a year stop here. Right now, Kenny Wallace is out in front, but we had a little shuffling and banging on that last restart. As Wallace and second place man John Wood tried to work their way around the younger of the Racing Wallace clan, Stephen. But waiting on the cleanup right now as they remove a couple of safety vehicles from the track and he gets it to go back to green.
I'm not sure what Stephen was doing here. He got up too far ahead of Kenny Wallace, so he backed off. And as he was backing off, trying to get in line, and obviously Kenny Wallace just took off. Now, if you watch him going down the corner, he boots the 47 out of the way, gets into his bumper, knocks him out of the way. And I'm not sure what that was all about. He was two laps down and John Wood was in second. But as the caution came out, I saw John Wood drive up and boot the 64 in the rear bumper, letting him know that he didn't appreciate that move.
Just something we can all keep our eyes on.
Yeah.
About 21 car, Ralph.
Alan, as you mentioned, Kevin Harvick's pit crew got him the lead on that last round of pit stops. This is his Nextel Cup crew servicing the car today. His regular Busch crew is helping Timothy Peters down pit road a little bit in the 29. Now, Harvick's car has been tight all afternoon. They'd let a little air out of the left rear and took one round out of the track bar. They're really afraid to have to go to their last set of tires, Alan, which is scuffs. They've been running stickers all day today, and they're very comfortable on that. He's still trying to dial this car in.
Once more, I think, in the final 100 laps of this race. Harvick right now trapped in a little bit of traffic.
Taking three wide, going down into three. And makes it.
Wow.
Stephen Wallace is giving us Uncle Fitz right now.
You know, since he got knocked around there on one of the earlier cautions, he's had a pretty fast race car.
Yeah, you know, yes, he has.
Got a couple laps down. He's been up there racing with the leaders. If he can get one of the laps back on the track, then he can start racing guys to try and get the lucky dog.
I'm not sure that's going to happen right now because that 21 car of Kevin Harvick is coming, and he's coming in a hurry. Oh, Montoya goes around. He may have gotten a little bit of help.
Ooh, wow.
I think the 66 of Jason Keller may have got into the bumper of Montoya. Now Montoya's got a little bit of damage here in the left rear.
Caution out once again. That'll be number 9. Let's see. Oh, yeah. That was a race for 10th position. Montoya has brought a little international flavor to the grandstands here in Memphis. Colombian flags in display.
You can get a lot. You can get those anywhere here in Memphis.
So we'll check on the 42 car, see if you picked up any major damage. Doesn't look like it, though. Under yellow here in Memphis. Oh, look at those sideburns. I know, I'm supposed to talk about, see where your favorite NFL team ranks in NBCSports.com's debut of NFL Power Rankings. It's all at NBCSports.com. Did you see the sideburns on that guy?
Yeah, we need to drop that cam a little bit. I bet you can find him again.
Wow. Of course, this is the land of Graceland, home of Elvis. As we continue under the caution, one lap to go with the back racing. Lindsay mentioned it before. She talked about an Elvis trophy. The trophy that they give to the winner is kind of like an Elvis statue.
Oh, it is an Elvis statue.
Yeah.
It's Elvis.
All right, any damage to Montoya's car in that little spin around, Lindsay?
Yeah, a bit of damage. They just brought him in and pulled out the fender a bit. They gave him right side. He's going to bring it back around and give him left side tires. But Montoya is an example of professionalism right now because he came over his radio. His crew chief first spoke to him and said, man, the 66 got into us. Montoya said, you know what? No, completely all my fault. How's that?
Well, it looks like he turned down over. You know, the 60, Montoya left the hole open down on the bottom. The 66 car went down in there, stuck his nose, and Montoya just drove down over the nose of Jason Keller.
Well, Juan Pablo's going to get another NASCAR lesson here.
Was he speeding? I thought he looked like he was going a little too fast when he left.
Don't have that little button on the steering wheel that you push for the electronics. So, lead change. Kevin Harvick. Jump into the inside of Kenny Wallace on the restart.
Well, I think Kenny's going to lose some spots right here. You got a bunch of guys right behind him, all over him, that are on fresher tires. There's a Johnny Sauter's going to get underneath him right here.
Trouble, turn four. Two around.
33 involved in that.
There's Jay Sauter in the 0-1, one of the first to go around. Cale Gayle in the 33 has driven away, but he was involved. And those other guys were just caught in the traffic jam. Okay, is it time yet to start talking about the record number of cautions in a series race this year?
Let's see what happened here first. Looks like maybe the 33 car is going to get a little bit of help there from Jay Sauter.
Ooh, he caught Mike Wallace, too.
Yeah, Mike Wallace got into that. In fact, when he went by, his car was smoking a little bit, or it's actually smoking a lot. He hits pit lane right now.
Mike in the one car there is Jay Sauter. Apparently can't get it fired up. Okay, that's the race record. So we've still got almost 90 laps to get us another five cautions.
Right
there he is, right there. Yeah, that's the one.
Toaster sideburns.
And the glasses to go with it. Very nice. Very nice. I've seen all kinds of machines at the gym before, but that must be a heck of a workout. There's another guy with big sideburns. That's Paul Menard.
Yeah, we talked about that earlier.
Driver of the 11 car. He's a big Elvis fan as well. Didn't make the trip to Graceland this year, but went last year. Said it was a big deal.
Okay,
have you been?
No.
Okay. I didn't know. I don't know what you were doing in your time here in Memphis. I don't know. Eating barbecue over at Graceland?
Nope.
All right.
All right. Look at that. Do a little bit of body work on there. Just pulling the fenders out, pulling that bottom valence out, making sure everything is straight. They got the time to do it.
Yeah.
I'm not sure if this is serving a penalty here or not.
Well, actually, the caution's a break for him because he gets to have his penalty under the caution. Wait, where's this Elvis music coming from? Well, that must mean we're going to a commercial. This is Paul Menard. He had a cookout in the garage last night celebrating his 100th NASCAR Busch Series win. He's a Wisconsin guy. Of course, he's got to have brats. One lap from going green flag racing, but for how long? That is the question.
Yeah.
Let's check down to the leader's pit with Ralph.
Shane Wilson is a crew chief for Kevin Harvick. Shane, how good is your car? Can you get it to victory circle from here?
I'm not sure. I mean, we've been a little off all day, a little tight in the center, but you know, we had a good pit stop and we made some changes, and hopefully that'll be enough. But you know, the double zero and the two car have been good all day, but it's going to be a good race to the end, I think.
Kevin's got a big day tomorrow, too. He's going to go right back to Atlanta for the race you'll see on NBC. How's his car down there?
He said it's pretty good. He's pretty happy with it, and see how it goes.
All right, Alan, got your bags packed to go to Atlanta?
Yeah. Yeah, be there tomorrow. Wally's going to come along, too.
Yeah.
Hey, do you know who's driving your Wally's World car today for the Bank of America countdown to green tomorrow?
Well, I heard Bobby Devani.
Okay.
These restarts have just been messed up as far as guys in the middle just not going.
Look at this.
Johnny Sauter breaks out of traffic around the lap car, takes second spot from Kenny Wallace, trying to bring Clint Bowyer through. Well, he's not trying to bring Bowyer through, but Bowyer's trying to follow through. How's that?
Bowyer will follow through.
He wants to keep that two-car behind him.
And you know, these last few restarts and everything, Johnny Sauter's been good. I mean, you know, he's hung right there with the two-car when the two-car was leading. But maybe they did adjust on that car a little bit. Booty and the boys make it better.
Grip. It has been lacking all weekend here in Memphis. Tough to get a hold of this racetrack. Well, you know, and it's funny how around racing we use terms like that. It's not tough to get a hold of the racetrack if you just want to drive around it.
Right.
But when you're trying to go as fast as you can go, it's tough to keep a hold of.
Well, you're always going to slide. You're always sliding these cars. I don't care how good they are. They're going to slide. You're just trying to minimize the slide. You're trying to have your car slide less in the corners than everybody else. That's how you pass guys. Good racing going on here. A lot of side-by-side right there in the middle. 0-1 car there. You see if Jay Sauter is down a lap or two. And you see Paul Menard there in the 11. Just for fifth spot right there. That's 60 car, Carl Edwards.
Nice job, Shane Huffman in the 88. Talked to Shane this morning. He said, getting used to super speedway racing is something I have to learn. But this racing on a short track, that's what I'm used to. He said, we've got a good car. We'll see what happens.
He's running well.
Yeah, solid job today. I mean, look, everybody that's in front of him is a Cup regular, except for Kenny Wallace and Johnny Sauter. Let's go back and look at that restart a minute ago.
Yeah, we've been seeing this a lot. Just trying to, they kind of go, and I think just try to anticipate it a little bit too quick. And he went, and they weren't going in front of him. He had to dive to the outside, did a good job not spinning the car.
Yeah.
And everybody else did a good job not hitching and running them over.
But Cleaver got shuffled back to 20th place. He was one of the guys that stayed on the track at lap 143 and did not take tires then.
And there you see the 88 of Huffman going by Kenny Wallace. Kenny Wallace is, you know, he's on older tires than these guys, so he's just basically doing everything he can right now for track position. Stay up there. Hang with them. See the 10 car of John Andretti looks like he's got some serious problems. He's coming into pit lane with some smoke coming behind him.
So Kevin Harvick starting to get away from Johnny Sauter a little bit. There's the gap that he's opened up. How critical might that pit stop be where he got out ahead of Sauter and Clint Bowyer a little while ago? How about second place, Ralph?
Well, you guys are wondering what adjustments they might have made to Johnny Sauter's car in that last stop. They're still working on that forward bite, which they've been doing all day long. They took another half pound out of the right rear this time, Wally.
So they've been dropping a lot of pressures. I think you also said, Ralph, they made a track bar adjustment, one of those pit stops.
Yeah, that's correct. They did earlier on in the day. I believe it was one of the first pit stops of the day. They lowered the track bar about a half a round.
So they're creeping up on it. His lap times are good right now. They're actually, you know, right there with the leader.
A little issue down on pit road with John Andretti's car. Looks like they discharged some fire extinguishers. The car was smoking when he came in. And looks like everything's calm there. Lindsay will tell us if there's anything more there we need to know. But a tough break for John. Here's the race for second place. To me, this is critical right here. Bowyer can't mess around behind Sauter too long. Oh, trouble. Got one in the wall. Heavy contact in the turn one wall for Bernie Lamar. Look at the nose of that car. Ouch.
That's what Delana just said.
Delana Harvick, the team owner. You see Bernie moving around inside the car. Taking off the safety equipment. That's good. That's a hard hit. The skid marks from where he impacted the wall move all the way back down the front straightaway. Almost like there was some sort of a tire problem or something that turned him straight up into the wall.
this is one of those tracks that have the safer barriers.
Yeah, he's
not happy with somebody.
He's told somebody he's not pleased with him. Watch it. Look at that angle of impact, and look how the skid marks come all the way back down the straightaway. Wow.
Yeah, that's a, and like I said, thank goodness for the safer barriers, because boy, he is hot.
Yeah. Augie Vidovich in the four was the car closest to him, but that doesn't mean he's the one to hit him.
Don't know what happened there, but with that angle.
But I'll bet you, Bernie will tell us.
He'll tell us.
And we may find out if we watch him for long enough. He's waiting for somebody to come back around again. Let's see.
I think he wants to talk to Augie after the race.
Me and you, buddy. Me and you. You think he was? You don't think he was inviting him out for dinner?
Could have been dinner. At a Japanese steakhouse tonight.
A couple of moments of excitement here. Fire on pit road. Everything's just okay in John Andretti's pit.
Yeah, let me hear it.
We say pit.
You say stop.
Kate and Tim don't know the score. Greg does. He got his credit score from freecreditreport.com. Don't be like them. Get the score. Log on to freecreditreport.com to get your free credit score and report, and you'll be entered for a chance to win an honorary crew chief position with Greg Biffle at a 2007 NASCAR Series race. No purchase necessary to enter or win. See website for details. Free credit score and report with enrollment and triple advantage.
I live for speed. You're running on empty. You gotta be in it for the long haul. Now that guy has the right idea. Let's keep going, buddy.
Look for special savings from Energizer on Cars DVD at participating retailers. Rated G.
Power will take you farther. Craftsmanship is alive. Passion is the ride. Born of GSXR heritage, the 2006 Suzuki Boulevard M109R features a dual overhead cam EFI V-twin and performance suspension. It takes cruising to a whole new place.
What do NASCAR AutoZone Elite Division fans, Twin Falls, Idaho, and Nashville, Tennessee have in common? The same thing that connects fans in South Boston, Virginia with the diehards at Altamont, California. They may be separated by geography, but they're connected by a passion for racing. From all of us at the NASCAR AutoZone Elite Division, to all of you in Greenville and Irwindale or Monroe, and all points in between.
Sunday night, it's crunch time. The games you can't miss are on Sunday Night Football. Cowboys, Panthers, Colts, Patriots.
Who's the best quarterback in football?
Then the flex schedule kicks in with Bears, Giants, handpicked by the NFL for Sunday night.
This copyrighted telecast may not be reproduced, retransmitted, or used in any form without the authorized written consent of NASCAR Broadcasting. NASCAR would like to thank all of our loyal fans for your continued support, and we hope you enjoyed today's broadcast.
Go online to NBCSports.com for a breakdown of Sunday's NASCAR Nextel Cup Series race in Atlanta. Marty Snyder gives us an exclusive preview. NBCSports.com. Don't do it.
Lucky Marty.
Got a lot of cleanup down in turn one. Bernie Lamar's car very heavily damaged. You're talking about tomorrow's Nextel Cup race in Atlanta. Denny Hamlin here today, running in 15th place right now, right in the thick of the championship. And here's a guy who's such a rookie. I talked with Denny yesterday up here in Memphis about that. You know, expect you to be feeling a lot of pressure. He said, I'm not. He said, this is bonus time for us, and you know what? We're going to go after it.
You know, we're going out for the whole thing, and we feel like that
it's feasible. We're less than 50 back, and we just got to maintain good runs.
Nobody expected them to be there.
Yeah.
And nobody really even still expects them to be there. So they're under the radar, so to speak. Everybody's expecting all these other veterans to win the championship. They're like, hey, man, we're in this thing. Let's steal it.
And look at these championship standings in the chase of the Nextel Cup going into tomorrow's race. 8 drivers, 99 points. 5 drivers within 48 points. It's amazing.
It's going to be fun.
Yeah.
I mean, it's going to be cool to watch over the next few races. And like you say, I mean, you look at guys, I mean, Matt Kenseth sitting up there is thinking what you said earlier. I just got to go out.
Go
put
win
a couple.
It.
Yeah,
just go win
put
it.
A couple top fives together. And, you know, it's mine. They have to take it.
And qualifying rained out in Atlanta yesterday. So the starting positions all by points. So all of the championship chasers are going to be up front. And racing for it when the green flag waves. Bringing the cars down pit road to give the rescue workers a little more room down in turn one, the cleanup workers, because they got a lot of liquid and then oil dry and the rest. So while they tend to that, let's check it down on pit road with Lindsay.
There are Goodyear officials here in John Andretti's pit, and basically they're inspecting what is left of John Andretti's left rear tire. You can see they're looking at a spot there to try to figure out what it was that John ran over that sliced the tire. But I just talked to one of the officials, and he said basically if the other half of it were here, would be able to tell a lot quicker. So, guys, I don't know. This looks bad, and it looks bad for John Andretti's Rookie of the Year.
So the tire went down, and that's what led to a fire under the left rear side of the car.
Right.
Okay.
That's what they're saying.
Thank you very much. Now we understand. Sometimes when a tire goes down, especially because they don't run the inner liners on the short tracks, the rubber gets wrapped around parts and pieces, and
yeah,
as you drive the car back to pit road, those parts and pieces get hot.
And you're dragging it. You could be dragging some rubber underneath the car.
And John is back in the race after repairs have been made and is 8 laps down in 36th place. Well, Juan Pablo Montoya shuffled back to 29th place from 10th after his spin at lap 155, trying to pick his way back up through the field. And Montoya showing in 20th place right now. Gotten a couple of good NASCAR lessons so far today.
He's doing a good job so far.
Let's go back, take another look at what happened in turn one that put us under this yellow.
Can't really see what caused that, but he did take a shot, and he knows what caused it. I mean, we can talk to him. He can tell us. He thinks the four caused it.
Ivanovic in the four car.
See, there's damage on the hood. I'm not sure when that happened, but there's quite a bit of damage on the hood.
So the cleanup continues, and we check with Ralph.
Alan Booty Barker, crew chief for Johnny Sauter, the 00, just radioed in and said, hey, this cleanup is probably going to take about another 5 laps, so there's probably only going to be about 60 or so to go when we finally get back to green flag racing here. He figures pit stops are over, and he told Johnny, you're probably going to have to race your way to the finish with what you got. And he said, the biggest thing is, I'm not telling you anything you don't already know, but don't overdrive the entry into the corner. If you don't, it will help you off the corner. And Wally, that's what everybody has been chasing here all day long, getting from the center of the corner off.
Yeah, that's what everybody's been complaining about, except maybe the two. I think maybe they're the only guys that have been struggling with that.
Yeah, I'm just thinking about that whole we're done pitting for the day. They stopped with 107 laps to go and got 29 cars on the lead lap. So if you've got another set of tires in the pits, that's going to be a tough call for a crew chief. Let's check with Lindsay.
Alan, they say one action lover finds another very easily, and we found John Snyder on top of Carl Edwards' pit box. Of course, John Snyder, otherwise known as Bo Duke. What are you doing on Carl Edwards' pit box?
Hey, well, Carl and I first met back in Vegas at the race last year, and he said, can I drive your car? I grew up watching Dukes of Hazzard. So I said, sure. So we took some hot laps around the Vegas Speedway, and one of these days, maybe we'll race each other. But the deal is, I get to drive his car, and he has to drive mine.
Have you gotten to try his yet?
No, not yet. But he's one of the only ones that's not dented up out here today, so, you know, it's pretty cool. I don't know how he's staying out of all that mess.
Well, you got to tell me, have you ever heard Carl do your yee-haw version?
No.
Can you do it for me here?
Me do yee-haw?
Yeah.
Okay, look out. It's very loud.
Yahoo!
There you go.
Perfect. Yeah. Love it. So I had a Dukes of Hazzard big deal when I was growing up, so
yeah,
that's pretty cool.
Good, you're a good girl. Watch for Collier & Company, new movie about racing. Racing. You know what that is.
You guys are big Dukes of Hazzard fans, aren't you?
I think we just learned something about Lindsay.
What would that be?
Well, she said she had a Dukes of Hazzard thing.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, that would be then her fantasy ride right there. The General Lee, right? You're not commenting. That's probably smart. Well, cleanup just about done. We should be going racing shortly. And let's see how much green flag racing we can get. Okay, here we go. Besides the opening 47-lap run of the race, it's been the longest green flag stretch we've had today.
What has been?
Yeah.
8 laps?
Higher. Actually, a lot higher.
Really?
36.
Oh, okay. Well,
we had one 36-lap run and one 47-lap run.
It seems like such a long time ago.
And a lot of wrecks in between, yeah. It's been the story of the day.
All right, one to go.
And here's something, because all these cautions, somebody gets back a lap back, right?
Right.
Remember Stephen Wallace a couple laps down earlier?
Yes.
He got the lucky dog pass 2 times in a row. He's back on the lead lap.
22nd spot.
Yeah.
Actually, there's quite a few guys on the lead lap right now.
Yep.
29 cars.
So here we go. With 62 laps left in this race. There's Stephen. And Kevin Harvick bringing him down.
They only have Jay Sauter down on the low side. Looks like the first 3 cars easily will clear him going into turn 1. And there goes Boyer underneath double 0. Johnny Sauter side by side down into 3. Boy, it's going to be hard to hold that 2 off. Boy, Johnny Sauter's got a peg. He's not giving him a whole lot of room, but they come on 4 side by side.
So Boyer to 2nd, behind his teammate Kevin Harvick.
It's Carl Edwards now wanting to take a peek, possibly. Johnny Sauter.
And Shane Huffman right there. The 88 car also. Nice run for that team today. Best finish of the season so far. Oh, trouble behind them. Turn 2. 2 cars around. Regan Smith, 35. John Wood, 47.
90 got spun around, Stephen Light.
And caution number 12.
Nice. That's not really what Harvick wanted to see.
No, let's see if we can do a little video sleuthing here.
Well, you see the 35 car down on the bottom just leaning all over the 47 car of John Wood. As they go down in turn 1,
so this
looks like Regan Smith is going to.
This was a carryover, is what it was.
Yeah. Boys.
You bump me off turn 4, I'll bump you off turn 2.
And I'm not totally against that.
Yep, Montoya right in the middle of that, Stephen Wallace. Little sod on the windshield.
Looks like a Weber divot to me on that windshield.
Yeah. So John Wood on pit road, and let's check with Ralph.
Now Bernie Lamar is out of the infield care center. Bernie, are you okay? And what happened over in turn 1?
I've seen the Ford in pit, and we came in and pitted and took tires, and we were going forward. He was falling back, and we've been strong, fierce rivals in the past, and if I touch him, he'll touch me back and everything else. But I got under him, touched him just a little bit, and then was going by him, and then he hooked me right in the right rear, and I think sent me right in the fence.
How scary is it when you take a just about direct shot head-on into the wall like that? Because the tire marks were frightening.
Well, obviously I had somebody watching out over me over today, and I mean, I just hate it for the Dollar General team, and you know, this is my last race with KHI. My crew chief, Gene, did a great job. We were a little bit tight there at the beginning, and he got it loosened up. We were going back forward again. It's just unfortunate to end like this.
Alan, a frightening hit from a couple of old fierce rivals who grew up racing on the West Coast.
That may not be the last fierce hit we see today between those two. Stick around.
When you see those skid marks, you say, thank goodness for the safer barriers.
Well, let me tell you, I don't know what happened, but if you hook a guy going down into a corner like that in the right, you know, like in your right rear quarter panel, if a guy hooks you, tell you what, I'd be waiting afterwards to have a conversation with him, because that's the worst thing you can do to a guy is to hook him going down the corner, because he's going to hit the wall straight.
Yeah.
And that's the, you know, other than getting hit in the door, the worst thing you want to do is go into a wall straight head on. But I'm sure there's another side to that story.
Oh, always.
So,
yeah.
I mean, you know, we've got to hear from Augie too.
John Wood has been assessed a one-lap penalty for rough driving for his part in that last little encounter. So 47 car will no longer be on the lead lap. I actually wasn't. He was a lap down already, so he's now two down. So,
hey, you know, you're digging so hard for position, and you're racing out here. Everybody's racing hard. And when you feel like somebody's gotten into you or passed you uncleanly, like that's what John Wood thought, you're going to retaliate. You don't think about the one-lap penalty when you're involved in that situation on the racetrack.
The pace of this race has just slowed down, and you want for these guys to be able to go race for it now. You got Boyer up there with Harvick and Sauter, and Carl Edwards keeps coming closer and closer and closer to the front, and you want them to get some green flag laps here so they can race for it.
Yeah, and 41 car's up there now. We haven't really talked about him. He's sitting there in the eighth spot, Reed Sorensen.
Yep.
And then you got Jason Keller, and then Casey Kane in the 9 car is in the top 10 now.
Creeping his way toward the front. Talk about Clint Boyer, the driver, of course, who got a win here 1 year ago and made his breakthrough in the NASCAR Busch Series by sharing a car with Kevin Harvick for Richard Childress a couple of years ago. Now, of course, on the Nextel Cup circuit, I talked with Clint on Friday about, you know, there's a point in every driver's career when he first gets here where something clicks and he feels like he belongs. What was that for Clint?
In 2004, when I shared duties with Kevin Harvick, you know, went to Texas, qualified like sixth, and, you know, I thought, well, maybe this isn't so, you know, so hard after all, and wrecked about 10 laps into the race, and then I really was like, this isn't for me, I can't do this, and, you know, the very next week, we went to Nashville and ran really well, led laps, and, you know, almost won the race, and that point on, you know, it really showed me that, you know, gave me a lot of confidence in knowing that, you know, I belong here.
And that's what this is all about. It's about confidence. I mean, drivers are very insecure, and, you know, you take it hard when you don't have a good weekend. It's a lot of peaks and valleys in this sport, and, last race. That's very true. That's how a driver looks at it.
Yeah.
And, you know, drive and have 5 great races and then have 1 bad one, you go, well, I've lost it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So
yeah.
That's how drivers think.
Well, Clint Boyer trying to make his last race, his latest race, a good one, running second to Kevin Harvick now. And I'll tell you what, Shane Huffman all over Carl Edwards. That 88 car, JR Motorsports, owned by Dale Earnhardt Jr.
He's been running very good all day. He's kept his nose clean. He's been real careful.
Yep.
Taking a look right now. He's right there, right on the back bumper of the 60 car.
Oh, I was waiting for him to hit him there and move him.
Pretty close.
Yeah. This is a race for 4th place. Huffman, a 32-year-old from Hickory, North Carolina.
He's got a really good car right through the center of the corner. You see, the 60 car just pushes up a little bit. He can't run that low line all the way through. He kind of diamonds it. For the 88 is Shane Huffman. His car is on the bottom. He's getting through the center a little bit. I think if he can get far enough up, like right there, I believe he'll pull the pass off now.
You know, when people talk about the next L Cup drivers racing in the Busch Series, here's the plus side. Here's a young kid like Shane Huffman out here able to test himself against Carl Edwards that he just passed. And Clint Boyer and Kevin Harvick and Mark Martin when he races. And, you know, people like that. He's able to measure himself against these guys.
Yeah, and, the thing about it is you're getting to race guys that you know are going to race you clean, that aren't going to make a mistake and take you out and do something stupid. So, yeah, that is the benefit side of this. There's the 66, Jason Keller taking a spot away from Kenny Wallace. That's the eighth spot.
That's J.J. Yaley trying to rally back. Remember, Yaley was involved in a spin back at lap 148. Dropped him out of the top 10 at that point. Well back in the field.
Wallace is going to look like lose another spot to the 20 car of Hamlin. Kenny Wallace losing about three or four spots there in just a lap and a half.
Remember that Kenny Wallace did not pit at lap 143 and the other leaders did, so right. He's on older tires from them. Kenny's last stop was at lap 100, so he's got 100 laps on his tires.
And he's doing a good job with that. I mean, there's not much you can do. You've got less grip than everybody else out there that has changed tires. There's Casey Kane underneath him for a spot. So Quinn Jr. in the 50 car taking a spot.
A nice job by him today. Yep. Haven't had a chance to call his name much, but one of the guys from the Roush Racing Gong Show, if you will, the invitation auditions to get a ride for this year. They called it the Driver X program. The guys who finished at the head of it were supposed to get a ride in the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series this year. They put O'Quinn straight into a Busch Series car. Got a fifth place finish, his career best at Lowe's Motor Speedway, last race out 2 weeks ago. And he is looking to see if he can catch Casey Kane for the 11th spot. About the 9 car, Ralph.
Well, this is a car known as Wind Back Flame that Casey Kane is driving. The team went to a horse race in Richmond earlier this year.
Trying to rally back on Shane Huffman. Third place. Remember that Edwards and all the other Cup drivers in this field started at the tail end today.
Clear all around.
Because somebody else qualified their cars for them here this morning while they were at final practice, or at one of the final practices, down in Atlanta for tomorrow's next L Cup race. So Carl back to third, to fourth, and Shane back to fifth. Did I say third before?
Yeah.
My bad. That whole counting thing, you know?
Yeah, it's been a problem for you for a long time.
How about Juan Pablo Montoya? Where's he at?
He is in 16th, but he's doing a good job. I've been keeping an eye out on him, and he's been picking his way through traffic, keeping his nose clean. He's learning a lot.
Fell back as far as 29th with his spin at lap 155. A lot of cautions, not a lot of green flag racing to make up spots, but Montoya trying to pass Justin Labonte here for 15th spot. And got it. Talked with Juan Pablo yesterday about the biggest difference between the cars he's been racing and the cars he's racing now from the driver's seat. What he has to learn the most behind the wheel to adapt to this form of racing. Here's what he said.
There's a lot of things that are easier than I thought, and some things that I thought were going to be really easy, and they're really hard. You know, it's like balancing the car is really hard. You know, an open wheel to balance the car is not as difficult. You know, going fast in an open wheel is a little bit harder. Here, going fast is not as hard as getting a good balance.
Just a couple of the things that Juan Pablo Montoya is focused on and dealing with. You know, one of the things I was most impressed with, though, Wally, he came into the press room yesterday after the end of practice here in Memphis and met with the members of the media and had a pretty wide-ranging discussion, a very frank discussion, and he said, I'm having fun. He said, this is a blast. He said, I want to win. I don't want to embarrass myself, but I want to have fun. I like to race. Getting out there and seeing how far you can push a car to its edge and whether you can control it or not. He said, that's the fun of racing. And he said, I'm just having fun with this.
Well, I mean, the difference is you've got a guy that's, you know, won the championships in IndyCar, won the Indy 500, won for luck. He's not doing this for the money. He's got all the money he needs. In fact, I wish he'd give me some. Oh. But, you know, the thing about it is, this is a guy that's not worried about his job, so to speak. He is here having fun. He's proved all these other things. He's proved that he's a great open-wheel driver. And now he's getting hooked up with one of the best teams in the business. And absolutely, this is a totally different mindset or agenda than some of these other guys racing here. Ralph?
You know, Wally, I was speaking to Brad Parrott, who's crew chief in Juan Pablo this weekend, and I asked him, what was the biggest surprise that you found when setting up the car for Juan? And he said, I was amazed at how quickly I could start bringing up the race car for him. He said, in fact, I probably need to go farther to the free side of the setup for the machine to get Juan really as quick as he needs to go. And then I was talking to Chip Ganassi earlier today, Alan. Alan, he said the biggest thing for him was that in reality, it was Juan who had to talk Chip into doing this more than Chip talking Juan into it, because Chip wasn't so sure that they'd be able to get Juan free of his McLaren contract early enough. They thought it wasn't going to be until the middle of October, and they didn't think they'd have enough time to get him up to speed before Daytona, the 2007 season. Now that they're underway, there's even an outside possibility, if everything goes right, he could be in a cup car at the season finale at Homestead.
Yeah, and I found him to be very cordial and having a good time, very aware of what's going on in NASCAR racing, you know, has been following the sport a lot and knows what's going on.
But when he gets to that next level in Homestead, it's going to be a lot tougher.
Montoya running 14th, Kevin Harvick leading, Clint Bowyer closing in on the finish here in Memphis. NASCAR Busch Series Racing from Memphis, presented by Propane on NBC Sports. Kevin Harvick leading as we close in on the finish of this one. Really thought once Clint Bowyer and his teammate got to second, he might be up there to challenge Harvick, but Kevin has pulled away.
Yeah, Kevin seems like he's getting through traffic a little bit better. He's just catching the traffic at better spots. And Bowyer, I've seen, has been hung up a couple of times. Just, you know, guys not getting out of his way or just being in a bad spot. So right now, Clint Bowyer is about a second and a half back, Lindsay, from the leader, Kevin Harvick.
Yeah, look what I found in Clint Bowyer's pit. You guys see these sunglasses? They let me bring some.
Okay, we got them now, yeah.
Now you do. Okay, here's the deal. Like you said, Bowyer is chasing Harvick. The last place he wants to be is behind his teammate, because he feels like so many times he's finished second to him, he feels like Memphis is his home. Because part of the reason, of course, is he loves Elvis so much. Well, this is his home. These guys got to take a field trip on Thursday to Graceland. Clint Bowyer wasn't able to go with them, but these guys said it taught him a thing or two in team bonding, and they were trying to basically make Clint feel like they could take him up and have appreciation for his music choice. You guys love it, right? You want some of these?
Okay, of all the corporate training exercises that I've heard of to build team bonding,
exactly,
a trip to Graceland is not on the list.
But you know what? They all got free sunglasses, so it's cool.
There you go.
Yeah.
That's a good one for you, Lindsay.
Thanks, guys. I'll bring you something.
Yeah. That makes sense now. I was wondering about the sunglass deal, because the whole team's got the same pair of sunglasses. I'm like, one of those guys must have got a new sunglass deal somewhere. Now it makes sense.
They did.
The Graceland sunglass deal.
25 laps to go in this one. Figure skating coming up next on NBC. Late Halloween on Ice, starring Nancy Kerrigan. That's right after these NASCAR boys finish slipping and sliding around this Memphis Motorsports Park. Clint Bowyer trying to get up and do something with Kevin Harvick. In the meantime, he's got to watch out, because here comes Carl Edwards closing on him for second place. The handle just looks like it's going.
Yeah, I was just going to say that, because all of a sudden, he lost about a half a second to the leader, and then boom, there's Carl Edwards. And he's got the spot. Carl Kyle Edwards moves into second place.
So our last commercial break of the race, 23 laps to go. Can Edwards get up and challenge Harvick for the win here in Memphis? Caution has just come out in Memphis. Jason Keller has been sent for a loop in turn three. He's running just inside the top 10, and the yellow flag waving with 19 laps to go. Just before the caution came out, Carl Edwards had gotten around Clint Bowyer for second and was closing in a hurry on Kevin Harvick.
Yeah, and and this is just what Carl Edwards wanted to see, was this caution. As you can see, Jason Keller got pinched down there in the turn three. He tried staying off the car. I believe that was Stacy Compton. And just kind of, they made some contact as he was turning and braking and spun himself out.
Kevin Harvick has won 7 times this season in the NASCAR Busch Series so far. Carl Edwards has won 4, but could have won a couple of more. We flash back to late August in Michigan. Edwards in the 60, racing Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the 8, and Robbie Gordon in the 88 for the win. Crashed. Then racing Casey Mears for the win just 2 weeks ago. Lowe's Motor Speedway Charlotte. Crashed.
Maybe he doesn't want to be in the lead right now.
Yeah. Could easily have had a couple of more wins, and now Carl with a late rally up to second place and was closing in a hurry.
Yeah,
on
he
Kevin
was.
Harvick when that caution came out.
Those last 4 or 5 laps he ran were definitely faster than Kevin Harvick.
This could get good.
Oh, I think it will.
Well, top of the day. Talked about fast guys start at the back. Those were all the Nextel Cup guys who are now at the front in this race. And all those same players and more will be in the Bass Pro Shops 500 tomorrow from the Atlanta Motor Speedway. Coverage starting with Bank of America Countdown to Green, 2:30 Eastern Time. Atlanta fast, 200-mile-an-hour speeds entering the corner. We always seem to see good races there, too. A lot of side-by-side action, great finishes that track has come to be known for as well.
Yeah, that racetrack has weathered enough now to where there's a bunch of different grooves on that racetrack. But it is fast. It's one of those places that when you take a lap around, especially qualifying, you actually hold your breath. I mean, you go through 1 and 2 so fast there, and you've got to be right on the bottom for those qualifying laps, and it is hairy.
All the championship contenders starting up front because qualifying was rained out, and that should be a great race with the tight championship. That's tomorrow here on NBC. What's Kevin Harvick's team thinking, Ralph?
Alan, this is chassis number 58. It won earlier this year at Martinsville, Indianapolis Raceway Park, and Richmond. It's a good, fast race car, but right now Kevin's saying it's lacking forward bite, and he feels like it's pretty much worn out. But obviously, this is the car they're going to have to take to the finish. The other thing to remember is we've had 7 different winners here at Memphis. Harvick, however, won this race back in 2000. We might have our first repeat winner here at Memphis, Lindsay.
Ralph, and remember I was telling you guys earlier that Carl Edwards has finished 5th here his past 3 times. Well, I just talked to his crew chief, Pierre, and he said that he heard Harvick come over the radio and said he's tight in the middle, he doesn't think he has it. They're very aware in this pit that that could all be bluffing. And Pierre just told me Carl Edwards has the car, they can take it. We're just telling him to go at it full steam ahead, and he could come out a winner today.
Well, he doesn't have to protect any points. I mean, Carl is second in the championship, but Harvick's already locked up the title. So what's left? Win the race. Just try and win the races. One to go. So it's going to be 14 laps to the finish. Only a few cars should be lined up in that inside lane, and the top 2 should be able to clear them pretty quickly because we've still got 23 on the lead lap. So Cale Gayle in that 33 car, owned, by the way, by Kevin and Delana Harvick, will be the first car in that inside lane.
Well, I don't think they're going to have too much trouble clearing him before they get to turn one.
I'm not a conspiracy theorist. I just thought that was worth pointing out.
I am.
I know you are.
But I don't think this one's going to be any situation.
So here we go. 14 laps to the finish. Harvick in 21, Edwards in 60. How quickly do they clear the lap cars? Can Carl get around Harvick and steal the win away? Nice restart.
took a look.
Oh, Harvick washes up a little.
And not quite at all. Boy, that 60 got a good run off the corner. Is he going to be able to get underneath Harvick? Oh, Harvick sees him. Not much room down there, but Harvick probably felt him before he saw him. He raced down in a one, and I think that 60 is going to have enough grip to do it. He does.
To the lead, 13 laps to go. First time all day, Carl Edwards has been out in front. Talk about a late rally.
And after those last couple of replays we saw at Michigan and Low Speedway, he wants to get way out in front.
Yeah.
He doesn't want to be racing anybody with a couple laps to go.
Fastest last lap. That last lap was Carl Edwards. He doesn't want to see a caution flag either. But you got 12 laps to go in the race on a short track. A bunch of guys all running for positions.
Mad at each other.
We'll see one. So they're trying.
Yeah, there's a five car. Justin Labonte in the four. Vinovich. A lot of contact and smoke between them, but keep it straight.
Haven't called Reed Sorensen's name all day. 41 car. Another one of the guys that started in the back after his car was qualified by Kevin Hamlin. One of the Ganassi.
Oh, wow. The 9 car. I don't know what happened down there, but he just drilled Jay Sauter.
And there's the caution that Edwards didn't want to see. This is number 14. And it comes out with 10 laps to go. Well, inconclusive. I'll bet this will give us a better look.
Jeez, keep coming, keep coming. Caution's out.
So it's drink these brake troubles again.
Well, but that one looked a little different than the last one.
That one
was off track
up
a little bit and started trying to reclaim the bottom lane there, I think. Montoya avoids another one in the 42. So a yellow flag out inside of 10 laps to go, and we'll check with Lindsay.
Pierre Cattell is Carl Edwards' crew chief. Pierre, finally, Carl takes the lead, and then you see a caution that maybe you didn't want to see. What does your strategy become now?
Well, a strategy now with this Freak Ford Fusion is to stay out front. I mean, I don't know what we're going to do other than try to hold him off. A week ago, we had the same situation. Didn't quite end up like we wanted it to, so hopefully Carl will get it done. The short track, we can get away from Harvick, we'll be all right.
How much would a win like this mean for Carl?
Well, any win is incredible. You know, I mean, to have it here in this area where it's pretty close to Carl's home means a lot to him, that's for sure. Short track racing is really great here at Memphis, and we'd like to put it away here.
Ralph?
Shane Wilson, crew chief for Kevin Harvick. Shane, you got enough to run him back down?
Probably not. He'd have to make a mistake. You know, he's beat Carl. That was an awesome run they just had there with a 60 car, and he got by us. You know, if he makes a mistake, we'll be there. We'll give it our best shot, though.
Can he help force that mistake? Can he get close enough to push him?
I don't know. You know, I doubt it. But if Carl slips up at all, we'll be right there. We'll definitely fill the real estate up.
Sounds like if he's going to do it, Alan, it's going to come on the opening lap here when he's closest to it.
Pretty much how Edwards got the lead from Harvick.
Yeah, Harvick just slid up the racetrack. He pushed.
And quickly on the restart.
Yeah, and you're not going to have anybody lined up on the bottom now, which is good. So it's going to be a clean restart.
Here's the Cat in the Hat, Jack Roush, team owner for Carl Edwards. Big smile, having a chat with Pierre Cattell, the crew chief. Beautiful day here in Memphis, though. You see those flags. The wind been very strong all weekend. Cool fall breeze blowing.
Great crowd today.
Yeah. And we are getting ready to go back racing. So this restart is going to come with 6 laps to go. NASCAR rules, inside of 10 laps to go, there's no double up for the lap cars. So it's just the lead lap cars at the front of the line, 23 of them.
And we are going to go racing and see if Edwards can get away from Harvick. And if we can run six laps without a caution flag with the checkered flag that close at hand. And the field clutch for a restart. Talked about this being near Carl Edwards' home. Of course, he is from Columbia, Missouri. This in Memphis, Tennessee, not all that far away. And let's see if Carl can take the checkered flag and give us a victory flip this afternoon. Green flag. Harvick with a great restart. Looking inside. Not enough.
See Hamlin diving underneath the 41 of Sorensen back there. It's about for the eighth spot.
Five to go. That is a car that is pulled off the racetrack on the back straightaway. That cloud of smoke you saw, that was Jason Leffler. He's gone into the garage. We stay under green.
Well, Carl Edwards is just, he's getting off the corners better than Kevin Harvick right now.
Look, trouble turn four. Stephen Wallace into the wall. Caution is out. Well, I'll say this. No one has tried any harder today than Stephen Wallace. He has been trying to hustle this car and pick up these spots that he lost earlier. That was his Uncle Mike right in front of him there. Whoops.
Good thing not to take out Uncle Mike.
Yeah. And so.
Well, you know, we didn't want to talk about it, but now we're going to have to because we are tied for the record of the most cautions.
At this speedway.
At this speedway.
The record for most cautions in a Busch Series race this year was in Martinsville. Late July, you and I did the race. 19 caution flags.
We're not going to get that today, fortunately, with how many laps to go.
I can see why you're thinking there was, I don't recall.
I don't recall.
As soon as NASCAR's done, figure skating, Late Halloween on Ice, starring Nancy Kerrigan. That's next on NBC. We are coming down to a late scramble to the checkers. Carl Edwards, Kevin Harvick, Clint Bowyer. And no, it is not true that the pace car will get the bonus points for leading the most laps today. What the go signal there?
No.
So they are probably trying to sort out the restart order for this final sprint. And we're going to get the one to go next time. And so that'll set us up for a green-white checker finish, basically. One shot at a green-white checker finish. They'll wave the green flag, race one lap, wave the white flag, one lap to the checkered flag. If there's an incident that forces the caution to be brought out anywhere in there, the race will finish under yellow and will be done. They'll use the scoring loops around the racetrack, the electronic scoring and video replays to determine the finishing order of the race at that point. So here we go. At lap 249 of 250 scheduled, we'll get the one to go and we'll restart at the lap 250 mark for the green-white checker. And the only thing Carl Edwards wants to see is Kevin Harvick disappear in his rearview mirror.
I'm not sure he's going to see that, but...
And no caution flags.
Yeah, all Carl Edwards wants is a very good, clean restart, a better one than he had the last time, because the last time was close to letting Harvick in an opportunity to drive underneath him going into one. Yeah. As long as Carl Edwards gets into one in front of Harvick, I don't think Harvick can be able to do anything.
Harvick's team, Richard Childress Racing, watching. Last year, Carl Edwards started in the back, raced his way up to fifth place. Same situation, was in Atlanta, was in Martinsville last year with his Nextel Cup team and showed up to race, started in the back, finished fifth, said this year he wanted to take it from last to first this time. Well, so far he's done it, but he's got to get away for just a couple of more laps.
Did not get a good restart
to the inside.
said, we got trouble up high there. That's Yaley on the high side, but
no caution.
Carl Edwards did not get the restart he needed, and that's all Harvick needed to fill that hole, going into one.
Final lap, white flag is up. Edwards left the race with Johnny Sauter for third place, and Harvick is clear of his teammate, Clint Bowyer. Final corner, and with victory number 8, if there's trouble behind, Kevin Harvick takes the checkered flag and wins at Memphis.
Kenny Wallace gets a piece of that. Paul DeHaan got drilled.
That is Justin Labonte in the 5 and Regan Smith in the 35 there, who had the contact in the final corner. Menard went spinning first in the 11 and was clobbered by that 35 car, with the 5 of Labonte just caught in the aftermath in the jam-up. So on our restart for a green-white checkered finish, Kevin Harvick makes the winning pass on Carl Edwards.
Yeah, that's like I said. I mean, that's all Edwards had to do was get in there ahead of Harvick, but he didn't. Harvick got a better restart. The door was open. That's all he needed. Then up in 4, the 88 drills the 11 car. Huckman gets into Paul Menard, turns Menard around, goes back down the racetrack where everybody is and can't go anywhere because you got the wall on the inside of you.
So Kevin Harvick picks up yet another win in what has been a championship season so far in the NASCAR Busch Series. His 8th victory of this year for Kevin Harvick. And the Coast Guard sponsor team celebrates there. While Harvick celebrates, this race has run far past its scheduled airtime, and so we will have to leave the air now. Sure, we'll hear from Kevin tomorrow on Bank of America Countdown to Green as we get you set for the next Elk Cup race from Atlanta tomorrow afternoon, 2:30 Eastern, here on NBC. So Kevin Harvick, the winner, rallying back on a late green-white checker finish. For Lindsay Zarniak, Ralph Shaheen, and Wally Dallenbach, this is Alan Bestwick saying so long from Memphis. Talk to you tomorrow from Atlanta.